You allow me. Can someone please confirm if they can hear me clearly?
Yes, please.
We can hear you.
Thank you. So, good evening, everyone. My name is Adeoluwa Adetu, and I am a business analyst. Tonight, we'll be taking you on requirements elicitation, myself, and documentation. So, it'll be myself and Uzo Okezie. And we've got the agenda right here. I will be We've got the agenda. We've got requirements, solicitation, and management. We've got the show and tell, and we've got the questions and answer. So we'll split it in two ways. Before I go on, can I just do a few quick ground rules, please? So if you have any questions, can I ask everyone to please make a note of it, and we'll take those questions in our Q&A session so that we can walk through the slides quickly, get the requirements, solicitation, and management, get all of that in, and then we'll be taking our questions and answers at the end of this. So if you can please do that, that would be great. So like I said earlier, we were doing requirements, solicitation, and management. I will be taking the definition, the types of requirements, and Uzo will be taking requirements framework and the requirements elicitation part of the presentation. The show and tell, what we'll be doing is that Uzo and I will be doing the show and tell part, and then the questions and answers will be taken by myself and Uzo. So hope that is clear. So definition, what is a requirement? So basic definition of a requirement. And I will be, I mean, I'll like this session to be as interactive as possible, but I bear in mind that we're constrained with time. So I'll throw a few questions out there. If you guys can come back quickly, answer the questions, or just drop it in the chat box, that would be great. So definition of requirement. What is a requirement? I mean, in layman terms, I'm sure, I mean, in all our work, in all our things that we've done in life, we've come across this word requirement. What do we think a requirement is? What is a requirement in general term, not just in IT, not just in business analysis? Now, does anyone have an idea of what a requirement is, please? Can I get a quick message in the chat, or someone can just unmute and speak quickly, please? What do we think a requirement is?
I would say requirement is what you want to do.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you very much for that. So requirement is what you want to do. Basically, that's what it is. What is a requirement? In here, I have it. A requirement is a specific need or condition that a project must satisfy to achieve its objective. A requirement is a specific need that a product, not just a product, not just a project, that a product, a service, or a system must fulfill. So, for instance, let me just give like a quick example now, layman's example. My requirement: I'm hungry. What is my requirement? My requirement is I need to eat. So I'm hungry. I need to eat. I go to the restaurant and I'm saying I'm hungry. I need to eat. I know what I feel like eating. For instance, let me give an example. Maybe I feel like eating jollof rice, for instance, and I go to a restaurant. They've got something, or maybe they've got shawarma, for instance. What is my requirement at that point in time? My requirement at that point in time is a need. My need is hunger. Any restaurants can satisfy that need of me being hungry. But right now, I'm not hungry for shawarma, which is the restaurant where I'm at. I'm hungry for jollof rice, which is in another entire different restaurant from the one that I am. So at this point in time, that particular restaurant that I'm in does not satisfy my requirements. So remember, requirements must be specific. So now we've looked at the general requirements. I'm hungry, that's general. But specific, I am hungry for jollof rice. So just putting it in layman's terms so that we can understand what a requirement means. A requirement, so the definition of requirement is it's a specific documented need that a system, a product or services must fulfill. It usually will specify the conditions and the capabilities necessary to satisfy that requirement. Maybe it be a contract, maybe a project, be it a specification, be it a standard, or anything else. Requirements serve as the foundation for planning, executing, and evaluating a project. So in business analysis, requirements serves as a foundation. So that is your core in business analysis. What is requirements? It serves as the foundation for planning, executing, and evaluating a project or a product, for instance. So that's what requirement is. Benefits of requirements, for instance, it enables or it promotes clarity and understanding. Look at that analogy I gave earlier. I'm hungry. I'm hungry. And they've asked me at the restaurant, what would you like to eat? I say, I would like to eat jollof rice. So clarity. When I tell them I would like to eat jollof rice, they're like, oh no, sorry, ma'am, we don't have jollof rice here. You can check the next store. That ensures clarity because at that point in time, I've already said this is what I need, and they know that they cannot fulfill my requirements, and they're signposting me to the other person that or the other restaurant that can fulfill that requirement for me. So it enables, it promotes clarity and understanding because it's actually very important for us all to understand and be clear on what the requirement on what requirements is. There's an analogy down the line on this slide, and we'll see. Yeah, that will give us a clearer picture. But obviously, one of the key benefits of requirements is clarity and understanding. Clarity and understanding, having your requirements ensures that all of your stakeholder have a shared common understanding of the objectives that needs to be achieved on any particular project. And this reduces ambiguity or confusion on any, or of any kind. Simple, straightforward. The requirement is I want to eat this particular type of food. Also, another benefit of requirements is scope management. Remember that analogy. I'll keep going back to this analogy every once and off, ever so often. But scope management, what is a require? What do I want? The scope of what I want at that point in time is a jollof rice. I don't want shawarma. I don't want kebab. I don't want anything else. But so it already defines the scope within which my hunger needs to be satisfied. My hunger can only be satisfied by the jollof rice that I'm asking for. So that's one of the benefits of requirements. And it helps you to imagine if I'm a stakeholder and I come to you, oh, this is my requirement, I'm hungry. And you start scratching your head as a business analyst, oh, you're hungry. What would you like to? And you bring everything from this world. You bring all kinds of food, intercontinental, Chinese, Asian, you bring all of that food to me. And yet that food is not has not satisfied my craving for my hunger for jollof rice because it's not specific. So obviously, within one of the benefits of requirements is scope management. It helps you to model the scope within which you need to fulfill those requirements on the project. So quality, improved quality assurance, basically. What is quality assurance? How is that a benefit of requirements? It establishes the criteria for verifying and validating the end product. Quality assurance, ensuring that the quality meets the standard. That's just what one of the benefits of requirements, ensuring that it meets the standard as intended. It meets the standard as intended. Back to my analogy, I'm asking for this type of food. You give me different type of food. That has not met my desired standard or the function that I intended for it initially. So that's one of the benefits of requirements. Another one will be risk mitigation, risk reduction, risk management, I'd say. So what are the benefits? Remember, we've written down this one, you want jollof rice. You are giving me shawarma. I don't want shawarma, and that can blow up. That can come in. It can turn into something. And oh, I asked for this. I don't want. It can lead to a lot of ambiguity, or the situation can escalate. But when you have your requirements properly modeled and gathered your requirements, it helps you to identify not just prevent risk, mitigate risk. It helps you to identify potential risk and challenges early enough. Allowing for proactive mitigation early enough, once everybody is clear on what needs to be, what is the desired end, it helps us identify any potential risks or challenges earlier on. And it also leads to cost and time efficiency. Just like I said earlier, back to my analogy of the jollof rice, you've spent money, you bought Chinese, you bought Asian, you bought Middle Eastern, all kinds of food. And I'm telling you that that has not satisfied my requirements. Remember, you've gone out, spent time, energy to gather all of those things, all of the products that you've presented to me. But I'm still telling you that it does not satisfy my requirements. So, having a proper requirement elicitation or getting your requirements right from the first time helps you to mitigate, extra cost, and it helps you also to manage your time better. It also leads to better decision making. I mean, that goes without a saying. It helps you go do better decision making. You're making your decision. You're making not just you're making decision, you are making the right decision within the scope within which you're working. Enhanced communication, like we said earlier, clarity, focus, no ambiguity, no confusion. This is what we want, and this is what the end product looks like. And then also traceability. Remember, traceability and compliance. So requirements, what are my requirements? I'm ensuring once I gather my requirements and I understand what the stakeholder wants, it helps me to trace. So it gives me like a trail from start to finish, a traceability of my requirements. There's something called, I mean, as you go along with your training, come across requirements, traceability, and all of that. So these are some of the benefits of requirements that we have. I mean, going back to, well, going further, sorry, to the types of requirements. So there are different types of requirements within the business analysis field. So I mean, I'm not just, I wouldn't say, I mean, this is within the business analysis field, but it can apply to any and in anything that we do, it can, this is definitely applicable. So I'd like us to, listen quite carefully here. So requirements can be categorized into four different categories. There's a general requirement, there's a technical requirement, there's a functional requirement, and there's the non-functional requirement. So those are the four main categories that of types of requirements that we have. So what are these requirements? What do they entail? We can see this figure here, this diagram here, this picture here. You can see the general requirements. You can see it has different things on here. So general requirements more or less encompasses like a high level expectation that apply to the particular project you're working on or the particular product, for instance. So remember, general requirements are high level requirements. So going back, I don't think I'm thinking of another example to use now, but I mean, just general requirements, high level requirements. I'm hungry. Remember, I'm hungry. It's talking about in this general requirements, we're looking at things like the business constraints, the business policies, the mission of the organization, the business continuity, the legal aspect of things, branding, cultural language. So that is at the strategic level, which is the highest level. Remember, it's high level expectation. So the scope, for instance, it defines the boundary of the project. The business goals, the overarching business objective. So in any organization that we work for, we know that, oh, there's the overarching business objective. What's the business objective? What's the business aim? And all of that. So those are what general requirements would be. Technical requirements, on the other hand, is more, like we said, general requirements is high level. Technical requirement is specific. So the technical aspects or the technical things needed within a system to be able to produce that project or the project. So technical requirements such as architect, so architectural technical requirements, you've got your hardware, you've got your software, you've got in the hardware, you've got the structural, the system, the structural framework that is designs the organization, the hardware, the computer, your CPU, and all of those things. Software, the software that runs on it, the operating system that runs on it. For instance, now you want to in just a random example, I want to deploy a Microsoft, for instance, I want to install my Microsoft product on a Mac computer. It's quite different for me installing my Microsoft software on a Windows computer. So those are your software requirements. So for me to install it on a Microsoft computer, I need to have this operating system on the Windows, whatever, Windows Server, whatever. On a Mac system, I need to have another operating system there. So the software requirements, those are your technical requirements. What are the things needed? What software, hardware, interface, internet, what are the things needed for me to be able to deliver that project or deliver that project, that product, for instance? I'm a business analyst. The company has told me, oh, we want to deploy this project and this is what we need. But for instance, let's say, for instance, they are running and we want you to deploy Microsoft Dynamics and they are running an IBM computer or IBM or some random web computer operating system that Microsoft products cannot be deployed upon. So this is where we start defining the technical requirements. We need to understand what are the things that are available within the system. What is the hardware? What is the software capability? What is the framework? What is the, what are the technologies that exist within that organization? And what do we need to be able to deploy this thing? So that's the technical requirement. Functional requirements more or less describes specific behaviors and functions that the systems must perform. So we think about things like data management. How will data be stored? How will it be retrieved? How will it be manipulated within the system? Those are the functional requirements, the things that, behaviors and the functions that the system must perform. Procedural requirements, processes, like the operations the system will support, input, output, processing, and all of that. Retrieval requirements, how would we manipulate, how would we get this data out of the system? How would we enter the data into the system? How will this data be stored into the system? Which data will help will this data be stored? Where is it going to be stored? Is it going to be on cloud? Is it going to be on a hosted server within the organization? Things like that. Those are the things that you need to consider when you're talking about functional requirements and also integration. How would this system integrate or interact with other systems or components within the organization? Because obviously within any organization, they want their systems to speak to each other. So more or less in a layman's language, how would the systems speak to each other within the organization? Those are the functional requirements. Then going to the last one, the non-functional requirements is things, it looks about things like quality attributes, like it defines the criteria that evaluates the operations of a system. rather than specific. You know, it thinks about things like performance in terms of response time. Oh, if I click this website, how long does it take for this website to respond to me? I want to, if I fill a form on the website, if I fill a Google form and I click submit, how long does it take for that thing to submit and send me a confirmation email and say that this and this has been done? So when you talk about performance, those are the non-functional requirements. We define the criteria that evaluate the operations of the system. The operations of the system, how do they respond? How do they interact? So you think about things like usability. How easy is the, let's use the website for example. How easy is it for a user to use the website? How easy and intuitive is it for the user to use a website? Security and access, you know, data security and resources within the system. How easy or how was the protection mechanism for the data and resources that are within the system? It talks about performance, you know, performance. We talk about that. Availability, usability, reliability. This reliability, the ability for the system to perform consistently under expected condition. The scalability, you know, what's the scale? Let me, what other word can I use for scalable now? The capability to expand and handle increased load on the system. What are those things? So that, those are the things that will be, begin to define within the non-functional requirements. You know, understanding and documenting this type of requirements ensure that your final product meets necessary specification and achieves the desired level of quality and performance. So we've got here the requirement framework. Requirement framework, what is it? This is the diagram here. On here, I have starting, you have requirements elicitation. It goes, so this is the first step. You do your requirements elicitation. So requirements elicitation is when you elicit requirements, when you source for information that helps you on the project. So obviously, usually the first step, requirements elicitation. So what do you need to achieve within this project? Tell us. You have that meeting, they do it. We'll have a show and tell later, and you see how exactly this thing works in practice. So this one goes into requirement analysis. So you're the business, you're the business analyst, they'll come to you, they said, oh, you've elicited your requirements. This is what we want, blah, 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 blah. You go and analyze the requirements and draw up your mock-up, you draw up your wireframe, you draw up all your things and say, okay, I've analyzed this requirement. Does this make sense? Does it not make sense? You kind of like clean it up and filter it. And then you take it back to the stakeholders to validate the requirements. So validate the requirements. Does this satisfy all the conditions that you've said? Yes, no. Once they validate it, you get a sign-off. You do your and all of these things. So the requirement elicitation, analysis, and validation, all of that filtered into your requirement documentation. So your requirement documentation more or less kind of defines everything about, gives like a full detail of the requirements that you've gathered and like an approval and sign off. Okay, so this is the requirement of the project. So it serves as a baseline or like a benchmark that you can always refer to within the project. So this is what was defined. And never mind that these requirements can change time to time, but this is your baseline. This is your starting line. This is what we did. We have defined and has been approved that we want to achieve on this project. And you have that documentation there. Then requirement management, as you, especially within the agile space, as you are continuing, you know, you are going working on the project and you're continuing like that, you need to learn to manage your requirements or manage your requirement documentation. So things changes, change management. How do you change this requirement from this and all of that? So that's more or less managing. But this requirement documentation is key because that is your baseline at any point in time on a project. So requirement framework. Very Uzo, is that you taking the requirement framework? I think I will. Uzo, are you
Yeah,
there, please?
yes, I am. Hi.
Yeah, so I will hand over to Uzo now to take us through the requirement framework and then we'll go to the show and tell. Thank you very much, everyone.
Hi, hi everyone. I will take over from Adelu. Thank you so much, Adelu. Remember, if you guys have any questions, just take them down, and then at the end of the session, you can ask us all the questions you have. Okay, so Adeolu basically talked about the requirements framework and what it is. So it's basically just a structured approach. So you can identify what your requirements are, you can analyze them, you can validate them and verify them, you can document them and manage the requirements. So I'll go through all these different stages and explain what each one means. You know, so elicitation talks about eliciting information from people. So I just want to make I'll do that all through, just talk about best practice and what is usually done, in best practice as in what we're taught to do, and then when you actually start working, what you will find in actual practice. If you look at if you want to do some research regarding requirements, you actually find that you there are some terms that are used interchangeably. Some people use gathering information, some people use eliciting information. Gathering information is actually the term that was used previously, and it was changed to eliciting information because of what the words mean. That's why I like business analysis or IT. A lot of the words, what it says is what it means. It's very simple. So gathering information almost seems like you have to go around and pick up information from people, but eliciting information means you actually have to draw out information. So you have to understand the kind of information you want, the kind of requirements you want, and then you now identify who am I going to get this from. When you identify your stakeholder, and those are your stakeholders, when you identify who your stakeholders are, then you go to them and start drawing out information from them, eliciting information from them, like almost like it's deliberate, it's intentional. Your questions, the kind of questions you ask them, are the kind of questions that will cause them to give you the information you need. So a lot of times you ask why questions, you ask what questions, so why are we doing this project? Why are we doing this project? What is the benefit? Who will it affect? How exactly will it take place? Where is it going to be implemented? So these are some of the questions you ask deliberately to draw out, elicit information from your stakeholders, because you need to understand what their needs are and what their expectations are. Sometimes I'm in a project and someone says, oh, BAs write the requirements. I'm like, I don't come up with requirements from the thin air. I need to go to the stakeholders to find out what the requirements for the project are. And then once you're done eliciting all the information you need, usually that process is very, you make sure you get as much information as you want. Then you start analyzing the information, start interpreting and refining it. And it's like, is this clear? The information I have for this particular requirement, is it clear? Is it complete? Is it, is it possible? Is it feasible? Can we do this within the confines, within the scope of the project? That's when you start analyzing it. And that's when, you start thinking about things like, what is your definition of done? On when you when unless your requirements have met your definition of done, they're not complete. So you're going to learn a bit more about that when you start talking about like writing user stories, but pay close attention to some of these terms. So your definition of done is just saying, I need for my stories to be clear. I need for them to be complete. I need for them to be testable. I need for them to be verified. So all these things are things, you go through in the analysis stage of the requirements framework. If you analyze your requirements and you find out that they're not clear, like someone's like, I don't understand what you mean by this, you have to go back again to whoever you got the requirement from and then get clarity from them, clarify, confirm what it is that they want you to do. Maybe it's not complete. Maybe you just got a little bit of it and they're like, okay, so it, you want us to install, this particular software. What is it supposed to do? Or maybe what system is this supposed to replace? People start asking you questions and you realize, okay, this requirement is not complete. I don't have the complete picture. You start saying, oh, I don't know, I'm not sure. What you do as a BA, honestly, don't, you can just basically say, I'll get back to you. Don't say I don't know. Just basically say, okay, let me confirm, let me go back to the stakeholder to confirm this requirement. When people start asking you questions, which is one of the reasons we're going to come to documentation, but which is one of the reasons when you're eliciting information, you need to find out who gave you that information. Who is the owner? What stakeholder gave you that requirement? So when you need to go and get clarity or you need to go and get completion, you know who to go back to. So when you're eliciting information, always make sure you're writing it down, taking it down. During the we're going to talk about different techniques to elicit information, but always make sure that when you're whatever technique you choose, as people are giving you the information you need during elicitation, you're documenting it, you're taking it down, you're writing it down so you can analyze it. Then the next stage is validation and verification. These two work hand in hand. So you want to validate and verify your requirements. Basically, verifying your requirements is basically you're talking about the quality. So is this the right product for this need? Remember, I only talked about, your requirement is supposed to be the specific need of a business, in response to, okay, this business needs this particular thing in order to meet the business objectives. So when you're validating your requirement, you need to confirm this requirement, is it the right requirement for that particular business need? Does it meet the business goals or business objectives? And you need to verify the requirement as well. Does it add value? Do you understand? Does it add value? So your validation talks about, is this the right product? And then your verification talks about, is this the right product? And your validation talks about, am I developing this product the right way? So both of them work hand in hand. They basically talk about making sure that the requirement you have is the right one and it's being done the right way. Okay. So then you now go to documentation. Remember, we talked about writing down your requirements when you're eliciting, but documentation goes beyond that. Now, once you're done eliciting, analyzing, verifying, and validating properly, sorry, someone needs to mute. If you're not speaking, could you mute? I think you say thank you very much. So you need to document your requirements. Bisoy, please could you mute your microphone? It's interfering, if you don't mind. Thank you. So we're talking about documentation. You need to document your requirements, and documentation is basically it comes in many different ways. You can visually represent the requirements in such a way that the stakeholders are able to see the requirements and confirm that this is actually the requirement they need for their business needs. So there are many different ways to do this. You can there there's there, you can document it in a business requirements document, BRD, usually in a waterfall framework when you're dealing with waterfall projects. But this is an agile framework. So the way we document requirements in an agile project is through user stories. You can also use use cases, process modeling, wireframes, prototyping. There are a number of different ways to document your requirements. Again, we're going to talk about that a bit further down the line. And then the final stage of your requirements framework is the management phase. So now you've elicited, you've analyzed, you've validated and verified, you've documented. All right, we need to work through all these documents to make sure that they're done, because you're not putting down the documents just to put them down. They need to actually be developed or worked through. They need to be done so that by the time all that is done, is developed, you have the final product that meets the business need. So management is the process of going through all those requirements. You make sure that you've prioritized them, because sometimes you have loads and loads of requirements and people are telling you, okay, fine, we cannot get all these requirements done at the same time. So which one is the most important one? That's when you start thinking about techniques like MUSCO. So your must-haves, your should-haves, your won't have. So I'm not going to have that. This is nice to have, but I can't have that at this stage. Your must-haves are your most important, requirements. So these ones need to get done in order to achieve the minimum viable product. So it's called an MVP. I know I'm throwing a lot of terms at you, but please try as much as possible, take them down. If we don't go through them in this training, in subsequent trainings, your tutors will definitely touch on them and teach you about them. So hopefully I'm not overloading you with too much information, but just take some of these things down because they're very important in the process. So like I said, you prioritize your requirements and then you begin to work through the most important ones. Which one is in scope? Which one is out of scope? So that's where scope management, remember, Adeolu talked about scope management. You need to understand, okay, in this particular project, this requirement is in scope. This requirement is out of scope. Basically, that just means like, so if you're building a house for somebody, a swimming pool would be nice to have, but for the first phase of this product, the swimming pool is out of scope. We can have it maybe a bit later down the line, but right now we just want to build the basic house. We just want the bedrooms, we want the kitchen, we want the living room. Swimming pool will be great, but it's out of scope for this project. The kitchen is in scope, the bedrooms are in scope, the living room is in scope, but the swimming pool is out of scope. So basically, and then even with the things that are in scope, you now have to prioritize them and work through them one by one. You have to track them. You have to make sure that they're aligned with the business process. But most of all, you have to make sure that they're signed off on. Remember, requirements are not your requirements. They're the business requirements, they're stakeholder requirements. So there are people that own these requirements. The people are the ones who gave you the requirements. They're the ones that verified that the requirements are clear and complete. They're the ones that you went back to validate and ask, is this the right requirement? Is this the right one for the business need? And then when you documented them, they're the ones that look through to say, yes, this is complete. Sorry, excuse me. Okay. And then finally, they're the ones that you're going to be working with to track and make sure that the requirements are done, so they're complete. And then once they're done, you go back to them again, you demo it. So you once the requirements are done, you have your product. You go back to them again and demo your product to them and tell them this is what we've done so far. Obviously, like I said, this is an agile product and project. So your development is done incrementally each sprint. So after each sprint, hopefully, if you haven't learned about that yet, in subsequent trainings, you learn about that. But after each sprint, you go back to your stakeholders and demo what you've been able to achieve. You show them what you've been able to achieve for that sprint, and then they'll review it. They'll make changes and tell you, okay, this is good, but I don't really like this. For example, if you're building a website, they'll tell you, oh, I really like, the what you've done, but could you move the logo over from the left to the right, or could you change the colors, or could you do such and such and such and such? So they'll give you feedback. They'll review it, and then based on their review, you go and implement it again, do some more work, come back, demo it and everything. And that's how you go through until you release the product, once the release stage gets there. So that's basically walking through your requirements framework. Adela, please, could you move to the next slide? Thank you. So this is a very interesting illustration. So the first one is okay. So this is a need. Okay, we're talking about what a stakeholder wants. The customer is the stakeholder. So the stakeholder, this is what the customer explained. So this is how the customer explained the business need. This is how the project leader understood it. This is how the engineer designed it. This is how the programmer wrote it. This is how the sales executive described it. This is how the project was documented. This is what the operators installed. This is how the customer was billed. this is how the help desk supported it, and this is what the customer really needed. So if you look at this journey, it is just, it's humorous, it's hilarious, but in a way it explains, some of the things you see when you're in, when you start working. For example, the one that says this is how the project was documented. Sometimes you go onto a project and there's no documentation. Like you go there and you're like, okay, so can I have the project mandate, or can I have, can I find out a bit more about what the project is, the business case or something? And they're just looking at you because they haven't documented it and all of that. So as a BA, make sure that any project you don't leave it undocumented is one of the things that BAs are known for. And a good BA always documents their requirements or their project. You just, as you go through, you learn more about different kinds of documentation. So always make sure you're not the person who leaves the project without any documentation. But this basically, the underlying lesson about all of this is, as a BA, never make assumptions. Questions are your bread and butter as a BA. Yeah, so you must always keep asking questions. Don't be afraid of questions. Just keep asking questions. If you don't understand anything, ask. Sometimes they put you on a project and you don't really know anything about that project or about that industry. There's no need to get afraid or intimidated. Most of the projects we go on to as BAs, we don't know much about it. You don't need to. That's why you start asking questions. You ask questions, and then in asking questions, you find out what you need. Sometimes before you leave that project, you're actually a subject matter expert. So always ask questions if you don't know anything. Before you go for a meeting, make sure you do your research. So if, for example, they tell you this is what the project is about, if you know about that project, awesome. Or about that subject. If you don't, make sure you do research, prepare yourself so you're armed with the right questions, not just questions, but the right questions. Okay, Adela, please, we can move to the next slide. Okay, so we're going to go into requirements elicitation in depth. So remember, I told you that elicitation is drawing out, requirements, information from people. It says that this is the process of determining what your project needs to achieve and what needs to be created to make that happen. For example, the example someone gave me was actually really good. They talked about the fact that sometimes your business need is a puzzle, puzzle piece. When you have maybe like a 1,000-piece puzzle. The box comes with the picture. You see the final picture, and then you just drop, all the different pieces. Now you need to start, finding out which piece goes where, which piece is your corner piece, which piece is your central piece, and then little by little by little, you fit everything together until at the end of the day you get your final product. Requirements elicitation is like that. But the truth about it is, that's why anybody can be a BA, because these are some of the things we do all the time. Someone comes and tells you something, and you start asking the person questions to draw out information from the person. So these are skills that we use every day. Just that now we're using it for business, we're using it at work, but again, in requirements elicitation, you have to understand who the stakeholder is. Now, a stakeholder is anybody who is interested in that your project. Yeah. So, for example, the example that Adeolu gave, okay, she's hungry. She goes to a restaurant. Adeolu is a stakeholder because she's wants jollof rice. The restaurant owners are stakeholders because it's their job to supply what it is that Adeolu wants. The waiters are stakeholders because they need to find out what she wants and try and get her order, fulfill it, all those sorts of things, and so on and so forth. So if you come onto a project, everybody that has anything to do with that project, including the development team, the business, the customer. Sometimes your stakeholders are internal, sometimes they're external. You're dealing with vendors, you're dealing with external people. You have to identify all your stakeholders for that project. And then you now have to understand the importance, because not everybody has the same level of interest in that project. Some people are interested because they're the ones funding it. So their people come and say, oh, this system you gave us is not really doing the job. We want a better system. So they're like, fine, we want our business to do better. So we need a better system so that our people can work better and do their jobs. So they're funding it. They're interested in making sure that the business gets what it needs. But then the people that are using the product, they're the ones that are feeling the pain directly. You know, they're the ones using the clunky software. They're the ones, you know, their work is just every day crashes. They're the ones feeling the pain. So even though you have a business who says, yes, we want our business to grow and we want our, you know, workers to have the best and we want them to be able to do their jobs very well, satisfy the customers, the pain they're feeling is, yes, they're feeling it in their purse. Obviously, the business needs to grow and all of that. But the people that are using the system are the ones that are being impacted. What if it's a customer exchange system? You have the person in within the organization using it, and you have the customer outside who is being impacted by the system that is not working. So you have two people on both sides that are feeling the pain. So you now have to get requirements from all these people in order to make sure that the solution you come up with meets the business needs. So again, remember, identify who your stakeholders are, then identify their level of importance, identify who has the most important information. So you come onto a project and they give you the name of the project manager, the name of the finance guy, the name of the head of the organization, head of the department, the customer head, SME head, you know, all those people. You now have to identify who's the most important person in this list that you've been given. And there are tools to do that. Don't worry, we're going to share all of that with you. There's a stakeholder matrix where you identify your stakeholder, then you now identify interest, power, influence, like all those sorts of things. And then based off of that, you now plan who you're going to get the requirements from. And again, there are lots of techniques for getting requirements from people. So again, we're going to go through them, you know, a bit further down. You can interview them. Sorry, just if you go back a bit, thank you. You can interview them. You know, you can have a workshop, you can have a survey, you can shadow them. So sometimes people are doing the work and you're just observing quietly, you know, just watching how they do things. So there are many different ways to get information from people in order to get the requirements you want. You know, another important thing again is to when you're enlisting requirements as a BA, it's important for you to find out what the current system is. So for example, you come onto a project and they tell you, okay, we want to install a new system that is able to catalog all our data, make sure that it's protected, make sure that people can access it like one click. They don't have to go through, wait a long time to get data. It arranges the data for you. It makes sure that everything is done properly in a secure way, according to the way regulators need for it to be done. So that's all well and good. But in order to do that, you might need to find out what is the current process at the moment? Because when you find out what the current process is, you now find out what they want it to be. That difference between where it is and where they want it to be, that's where your requirements are. What do you need to take the system from where it is now to where they want it to be? There are terms for all these things. So for example, where the system is now is called as is. What's the as is process? As it is, how it is now. It's called as is. Then the one they want it to be, like the future one, the solution they want to prefer is called a to be process. So you now have to write down what the as is, write down what the to be is, and then you now find out what's the gap. Again, that's gap analysis. You learn a bit more about that. But then there are things between where it is now and where they want it to be. Those are your requirements. So there's so many different ways to get requirements based on, the project you're on. Again, you have to know what the business goals are. What does the business want to achieve? And then as a BA, see, you're not a mindless person. They hire you because of your knowledge, because of your expertise, because of the way you think. You're looking at the process and you're looking at the solution. And you're like, you have to be able to give your opinion. Sometimes you're just giving your opinion to say, this process that you guys want to implement doesn't really fit the need. It solves some of your issues, but not all your issues. Won't it be better suited if you do A, B, C, D, for example? Do you understand? So sometimes you can look at what the solution is, look at what the objective is, and then you can say, yes, these two match. So if we implement what the solution is, it will deliver and fix what their business need is. They'll be able to achieve their business needs and their goals. But sometimes you can look at it and say, it's not really matching. There are some gaps. There are some things that we need to, we need to fill in order to meet the business. You, as a BA, you can give your opinion. Remember, they're not your requirements. They're not your business needs. You're a bridge between the business and the developer. But sometimes you can actually come and say, I've looked at the solution. I've looked at what the requirements are. I've looked at what the objectives are. And there's a bit of a gap. Would you consider doing A, B, C, D? Maybe you can offer in a very respectful way, offer, some of your expertise to say, I've looked at you've done your analysis, your market analysis, and you're like, this is what our competitors are doing, or this is what people in the market that are delivering similar products to us are doing, and it's working for them. So if it's working for them, it'll probably work better for us. So you give your informed opinion. You're not just pulling it from air and saying, I think. Yeah, if you think, it's great. You're not really, they don't have to consider what you want. But if you're saying, I've looked at your objectives, I've looked at what the solution is, I've looked at the market, you're giving an informed opinion, people will listen to you a bit better. So we talked about eliciting requirements from the stakeholders, documenting them, you're confirming them, you're prioritizing them. Again, remember that our illustration, do not make any assumptions. Always check, 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 double check. Sometimes when you find out who your stakeholders are and you elicit information from them, you have that session, you're talking to them, you always leave them with, how best can I get back to you? Like, okay, I've taken some of these requirements down. Thank you so much for your time. We're going to do a bit of a demo later, but I'm going to put down these requirements. Is it okay if I send you an email with these requirements just to confirm that I actually got the requirements complete? Like, it's complete, it's done. Do you understand? So, and maybe the person tells you, oh, reach me on Teams. I respond to Teams better than I respond via email. So you can send the person an email, but also send them a message on Teams and say, oh, hi, I just sent you an email. Could you check and get back to me? I just want to confirm that I was able to capture all the requirements and these are the requirements you want, kind of like thing. So you don't have to go back to them again to pull them into an interview. Some of these stakeholders, they're very busy people, so it's important that when you have 30 minutes of their time, 45 minutes of their time, you come prepared. You don't just come and sit down and say, okay, give me requirements. You come prepared. You've done your research. You come with intentional questions. You come with well-researched questions. If you do have documentation, make sure you've gone over those documentations. And then if you have questions based on that, you cannot ask. So make sure that the time you spend with these stakeholders are you utilize that time because you probably may not get it back. Some of these stakeholders are so busy that before you get that time, even email, there's a stakeholder I've been chasing. I've gone back to the my my change specialist, the lead. Like, I haven't gotten, he has not responded on Teams, he has not responded on email. Small question, no, he has not responded. So it's like, a lot of times, some people are really hard to get, you know, hold of. So when you do get 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 30 minutes of their time, make sure you use it very, very, very well. We can move over to the next one. Thank you. Next slide. Okay. So these are some of the stages of the requirements elicitation. Please press click. Okay. We've talked about understanding the pain behind the requirement. That is a huge driver. The pain point is a huge driver. Yeah. Why do people want to implement this solution? What is that thing that they want to achieve? What is that thing that is paining them? You know, there's a data migration project that we worked on, and the pain point is that they had an a server on-prem. It's a huge organization and they're regulated, so they store a lot of data. The only thing that will make them delete data is the Data Protection Act that compels them after 7 years, if you're not using anybody's data, make sure you delete it. So that's the only thing that compels them to delete data. They have data and, you know, systems that have been on there. They don't clean any, they don't delete anything. So obviously their on-prem system is clunky. When their data analysts want information, it takes so long. Business reports take so long. There's so much information that people don't need. It's just so many things. No one wants to delete anything. So a lot of the data analysts, a lot of the stakeholders are they're just complaining that, you know, this is 2024, for crying out loud. Why are we still suffering like this? So the business has finally understood. They're like, okay, fine, let's move everything to the cloud. And then they didn't even go with Microsoft, which is a huge customer. They went with another very well-known data company. And the attraction is that they can get data in one click. So you just literally click on data. It will arrange the data for you. It will anonymize it. The speed at which you can get information, the quality of the information you get. So they're tired of slogging through information that something that takes a few minutes can take people days. And then by the time you give the stakeholder the data, they don't even want it anymore. They probably don't need it anymore. So that's the pain point. And if you understand that pain point, then you understand that the information has to be easily accessible. It has to be well arranged. So you want to integrate things like Power BI, like a lot of all those things. So when you understand what the pain point is behind the business need, it drives your requirements. And then again, you have to eliminate language ambiguity. So sometimes you have different departments that are, you know, involved in, they're all stakeholders. The finance department is a stakeholder, the governance department is a stakeholder, the data analysts are stakeholders, like so many different departments, and each one has their own lingo. So someone comes and tells you, okay, I want the DAC to be this, this, this. And then the governance guys, they'll tell you their own. The legal guys will tell you their own. And everyone's just talking in acronyms. When you're taking it to the IT guys, they're like, sorry, what does this mean? I don't understand. In the department, everyone knows what it is. But once you leave that department, people don't understand what it means again. So it's your job as a business analyst to simplify the language. How will you know? You ask questions. I'm so sorry. What does this acronym mean? You can have a glossary. So as you're going to different departments and they're telling you all the acronyms, you're writing it down. Okay, OHCM means this. This one means that. So you don't have to go back to them to keep asking the question again. As they're talking to you, you're taking all those acronyms down. You see it in a document. You're like, I don't know what this is. If you don't know what it is, then chances are the person reading it doesn't know what it is. So you just make sure that the language is simplified. It is also simplified when you're documenting your requirements. You make sure you document it in the simplest, easiest way. That's one of the reasons you're going to learn about creating user stories, where they tell you given, when, then. Do you understand? It's like everything is almost like step by step in basic English. So you eliminate a lot of that language that causes confusion or ambiguity. Then you identify corner cases. What are corner cases? Corner cases are some of those cases that are, they're not common. So as a business analyst, some of the questions you want to ask is, What is the worst case scenario? What if this thing doesn't work the way we want it to work? What are the risks involved in implementing the solution? And what do we, how are we going to mitigate this risk? So people are just talking about, oh, when we implement it, this is going to happen, and that one is going to happen, and everything's going to be great. And then as a bee, you're like, okay, fine. If we implement this solution, there are like 1,000 people in this organization. What if 800 of them decide to log in at the same time? What happens? Will the system, can the system take it? What if the system crashes? Do we have backup for the system? Like, so those are some of the things you, everyone's excited about the solution because it's going to make their life easier, it's going to resolve their pain. But you as a BA, you have to step back and say, okay, what are some of the things that can happen and how do we mitigate against them? So you ask some of those questions, you know, what if, what if, what if, you know, are we prepared to deal with this in this particular case, and so on and so forth. So that means identifying the corner cases and then and making sure that you mitigate against them. Then obviously you're going to have to write user stories. I won't go into that right now. You're going to learn all about user stories. Really great. Just basically taking the requirements and writing it in the form that your dev development team understands and that they can test. So once they're done developing, they can test to make sure that it ticks all the boxes, it meets all the requirements. Okay, and then obviously your definition of done. Remember, I talked about your definition of ready. Now you have your definition of done. Your definition of ready is when is your requirement ready to be actioned? When is it when is it ready to be worked on? So remember, we talked about it being clear, we talked about it being complete, we talked about it being feasible, as in possible. And then your definition of done is when can we say that this requirement has been met and it has been delivered? Most of the time, it ends with the review and the sign off by the stakeholder. So once you're done, you've done all your work, you show it to your stakeholder, and the stakeholder signs off on it and says, yes, this has been done. So you have to make sure that you have your definition of ready and your definition of done. BAs usually have it, QAs usually have it, and it's applied almost all through the life cycle of the project. Okay, so can we go to the next one? Thank you. Remember, we talked about different techniques for eliciting information. There are loads. I was just able to get a few, but again, these sessions are just, you know, a few hours long, like 1.5, 2 hours long. We're not able to talk through everything. Make sure you take out time and do your own personal research, read about some of these things. So I talked about observation. Some people call it shadowing. Well, observation and shadowing, yeah, they're interchangeable. Some people say they're different. It's just watching how things are done. So you go to your stakeholder who is the user. For example, remember we talked about like a call center stakeholder. So you're watching to find out how they use their current system. What's the business process? How do things go? So normally you can ask them, but sometimes you just watch and then just take it down, basically. Next one, please. Let me see if I can go through these ones really quickly. Oh, sorry. The first one is document analysis. Okay, so let's start with the first one. Document analysis is when you come to a project, and then these ones are not like the previous ones we saw where there's no documentation. These ones, they have documentation. So they give you their business requirement document, they give you their business case, they give you their what do they call it? Some people, they need to justify what the project is as your business case. They give you a lot of documentation to do with the project. So you as a business analyst, you now have to go through that all those documents. Sometimes, you know, it can include the project mandate where the project is actually listed. You can find some of your requirements from that document as well, you know. So sometimes some people may have started a project before you and they've done the process map, they've done some of these things before. So when you study the documents that have been given to you, you can actually get some requirements from them. So that's document analysis. We've talked about observation. Then another important one is the interview. So an interview is basically calling someone and just telling them, you know, okay, hi, hello, I'm the BA on this case. I'd like to find out a bit more about the project. Could you tell me blah, 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 blah. Like I said, those questions have to be targeted. You have to come prepared, you know, with questions, especially if you have some insight into what the project is about. They may have said, okay, welcome to the project. You're the new BA. They'll give you access. They'll share some documents with you. So you now say, okay, once you've gone through those documents, you're now like, okay, I'd like to talk with you just to get some clarity on some of the, you know, requirements, some of the objectives of the project. And then you fix a time with them. So as you're coming for that interview, you're coming prepared with the information you have already. You're coming prepared with some research you've done. You have your questions ready, you know, and then you're asking those questions. Remember, I talked about making the best of your time with your stakeholders. So that's an interview. Usually it's one-on-one, maybe two people. It's not really large. Once it becomes a large group of people, it's very hard to manage. So then you now say, okay, fine. If I have, I've been in an interview where they called me to have an interview, and there were, I think, about three, four stakeholders. They just started talking among themselves. I was like, you know, so I had to be like, this is all great. I'm sure you guys, you know, because they were talking about the project. It's not like they were just gisting. So in answering some of the questions I was asking, you know, people started chipping in and they started, you know, talking, and then it almost started going out of, you know, scope. So I had to reel them back to say, okay, so great. Thank you so much for providing that information. And I asked my next question. So, and I just realized that it might have been better if I had scheduled maybe like a workshop, because there were other stakeholders as well who were not there. But once you go beyond two, three people, it becomes a bit difficult to manage, to facilitate. You know, that's what we do as BAs. We facilitate. We that's the term you use. Again, you facilitate a workshop. So remember, I talked about a large group of people, a workshop when you have like different departments, different business units coming together on a project. You need to bring everybody in a room before you go to each one, one by one, by one, by one, by one. It'll take a lot of time. Sometimes the requirements can be conflicting. You know, you need to have everyone in the room so they can basically talk through what the requirements are, answer some of your questions. And then again, in these sorts of meetings, your questions have to be very deliberate. So you're asking them, okay, so what are some of the challenges you have with your current system? You know, why would you want some of this? And then they'll tell you, you know, because, and you ask them, so why? There's a technique in business analysis called the five whys, and it's to get to the root cause. So someone can tell you, okay, we want to use a different service because this other service was late. Okay, so why was it late? They didn't arrive on time. It was supposed to be for 5, and then they came around 6:30. By then it was late. Okay, so why did it come late? Oh, well, they told us that, you know, they had some issues with, you know, the booking, and they didn't get the information on time. Okay, so why didn't they get the information on time? You keep asking whys until you get to the main cause. Oh, the main cause is that, you know, our system failed. And although that, you know, we sent the order out early, by the time the system rebooted, they got it late. So it wasn't able to get to the, you know, they weren't able to deliver it with the earlier batch. So they delivered it with a later batch, and that made it late, blah, blah. So you're not saying, okay, the real cause of the issue is the system. There was a system failure. So how do we sort out the system failure and make sure? If not, you just change the vendor. That this vendor is very irresponsible. They came very late. You know, they didn't keep our order. If you hadn't kept asking why, you wouldn't have gotten to the main issue. So, you know, sometimes you have to ask some of these questions. You're not telling them, okay, so how is this solution going to be? You know, you ask why questions, what questions, how, where, who, Who are the stakeholders? Who all? So these are some of the targeted questions you ask. So you come armed and you make sure that your workshop is time boxed. So if you tell people they are going to be there for 2 hours, 3 hours, make sure you keep to time. Sometimes when people are together, like I said, it can get away from you. So sometimes you have to be a bit strict and you have to make sure that, oh guys, okay, can we talk, can we talk about this a bit later, or can we park this issue and discuss it at a later date or something? So you have to have that for what do they call it now? But you have to be able to get, grab at the c control back from. There are some people that are so dominant, and then they're talking, and some of them are very senior, so you have to make sure that you have a way of getting control back of your meetings. And then sometimes they're giving you requirements that are not really relevant to your project, so you have to make sure that you get, they give you the information you need. That's your job as a business analysis. And then the other one is prototyping. Prototyping is basically just based on your understanding of what the product is and all the requirements. You give them a prototype, you give them like a visual representation of how the product will be. It could be like a wireframe, so like something very just like a sketch of what it's supposed to be. And they'll tell you, okay, I don't like the position of this thing, can you move this here, can you move that there? So it's something that you just visually, you use to visually represent the product so that the stakeholders will see. Sometimes when you're talking, people, they have different pictures in their mind. So you now have to make sure that you show them what it's supposed to be. Thank you so much. We can go to the next slide. Okay, I think my time will be up. So I'll round up very soon. So we'll do a quick demo for you before. Maybe in the next 10 minutes or so. So documentation, I've talked about documentation, so I'll just skim through it. Requirements, sometimes you have requirements that are very, 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 a lot of requirements. So you need to make sure that you have the proper ID for them. Sometimes you need your ID is what you use to differentiate functional requirement in a waterfall. And project, you use your ID to differentiate functional requirements and non-functional requirements. So, for example, for functional requirements, you can say FR001 or something, FR002. So, everybody knows that these are functional requirements. Your non-functional requirements would be NFR0010, 0011, whatever. So, you have to make sure that you properly number your requirements. Sometimes you have a document that has loads of requirements. You should be able to tell your stakeholder, could you go to number 315? That's the one I need a bit of clarity on and so forth. So, we've talked about a user story. A user story is used in an agile. User story and acceptance criteria are usually together. So they're used in agile product projects to document the requirements so that your dev team understands what the requirements are. They can question it. They'll basically look through and make sure that they understand it. If they don't, they could ask you questions and get clarity. Acceptance criteria, again, all these things are written in the very very simple language. Acceptance criteria is the step-by-step representation of what, how this requirement, how this product, how this deliverable is will function. So when it's being used, this and this and this is what will happen. I click on this button and then this page is displayed, and then when I click on the page and then this one happens. So it's literally a step-by-step representation of how the requirement should work. So when the testers, your QAs are working on it, they know, yes, it does A, yes, it does two, yes, it does three, yes, it does four, and then they can pass it. And if any of those steps fail, they'll raise a bug and say, no, there's a problem. This doesn't really work the way it should. Process map, another visual representation of the requirement. So, if, for example, you're applying for a job, you put your application in, and then the system gets it, and then it gets sent to the HR, and then the HR looks through, and then HR selects yours, and the HR sends you an email, and then you get the email. So that whole thing is a process. It's like an end-to-end user journey. What are the different steps that a person will take to use this product? And that's called the process map. The representation of it, the visual representation of it, is called the process map. Use case as well. That's another visual representation, wireframe, requirements catalog will tell you a lot of these things. You're going to learn about them. So please don't worry about it. But these are some ways that requirements are documented. Thank you. We talked about observation. So I might skip this because of time. Talked about shadowing and formal observation and all of that. So we can skip this. It's fine. I've talked about it. Thank you. We've talked about a workshop as well. Okay. So in a workshop, there are different ways you can get people to talk, because you have stakeholders in the room. You need to be able to get them to contribute, to like give you their the information they need. Sometimes it's called you brainstorm. You're like, you want to reach a solution. So you know what the problem is, but you don't know what the solution is. So you just ask them, okay, so, you know, what do you think would work in this kind of situation? A lot of people, when they're doing their jobs, if you have the right people in the room, they have some of the answers. And if they don't, when they give ideas, you can get the requirements, or you can get the solution based on what they're talking about. So brainstorming is one. Round robin is just a way of getting people to talk. So if Uzo says something, she'll now say, Bisoye, is your turn. Bisoye says something. So he says, Adeolu, is your turn. Adeolu says something. She'll say, Dakpo, is your turn. So it's like everybody gets to talk, because sometimes you come into a room and some people are shy, they're quiet, they don't want to say anything. So it's just a way of making sure that everyone talks, because everyone contributes. Once you have the right stakeholders in the room, whatever it is they need to say works. Brainwriting, sticky notes, breakouts, group exercises. There are loads and loads and loads of different ways to get people to participate in the workshop. I won't go through all of them because of time. Next slide, please. Okay, so again, I think I've talked about some of this before, you know, preparing for the interview, coming ready for the interview, make sure you have the right stakeholders in the room, you use the right kind of questions. I've talked about the five whys, so we can move over to the next slide, please. Okay, so this is a very important one. I'll touch on it very quickly before we end. And these are some questions that can guide your requirement elicitation. So these are questions you ask yourself just to make sure that you are able to ask the right questions. And it's like, okay, so what do I know about this feature? Remember, you may not be a subject matter expert. You may not know about that domain. They could throw you into a project that has to do with something you've never dealt with. Again, don't be intimidated. Don't be afraid. That's literally what we do as business analysts and analysts. You get in there and then you do your research. You get documents. If you don't get documents, you research, you ask questions, all of those things. So you start by saying, what do I know? Sometimes you may actually know a lot. Sometimes you don't. If you don't, you get the information through research. Google is your friend. We have ChatGPT now, which is great. So, I mean, make sure you're well prepared. There's no excuse not to be prepared. Research, go in there prepared. Make sure you ask the right questions. You can ask, okay, so what assumptions am I making about this feature? Remember, I told you as a BA, don't make assumptions. Assumptions is deadly as a BA, because you have to go back to that stakeholder. And then when you go back again, the person tells you, I didn't tell you that. You say, oh, but I thought, literally, what did you say? As a BA, you write all the time. You record conversations with the person's permission. No, please don't record anybody without their knowledge. When you're going in for a meeting and you want to record something, just let them know, I hope you don't mind if I record this meeting. It's just so I can refer to it at a later date, because people are talking, and you like, now I've been talking for how long? I'm pretty sure you may need to go over this video again to be able to grasp everything Adeolu and I have said. So you just let them know very politely. If they tell you no, then you write, you take down notes, you know, and then you go back to them to confirm. What does this feature need to do? What is the end result? What are the pieces of this feature? What needs to happen next? What needs to happen before? So sometimes something needs to happen before something happens. So that's your process. Once you have the process, you know this has to happen before this happens. And then you can arrange, prioritize your requirements. So then what if, remember I talked about corner cases, what if this happens, what if this doesn't work the way you think it should work, what if, you know, so you ask all those questions so you can plan and prepare for them. Can we go to the next one? Awesome. So I've been talking for a while. I really, really hope you've been able to grasp information from a lot of the things Adeolu and I said. I know we've given you a lot of information, but this is recorded, so you can always go back. And then for all the different things we talked about that you're like, I don't even know what that means. What's a process map? What's a user story? All those sorts of things. There are going to be sessions that will tell you about those things. So don't worry at all. You're going to be very familiar with those terms. But now we want to do a show and tell session for you, just like a requirements elicitation session. I will be the product owner, so I'm representing the business, and able business analyst Adeolu will be the one to, she'll be the one to lead the meeting. So Adeolu, are you there?
Yes, I am, Uzo. Thank you so much for that. That was super insightful. I hope we all I hope we all learned a lot from that. I was just wondering, because they said some people need to drop up at 9:30, right? Anyway, it'll be recorded. Yeah, it'll be recorded, so everyone should be fine.
Yeah, the data analyst, yeah.
The data analyst. Okay. That's fine. So, yeah, are you ready for the role play?
Of course. Go ahead.
Yeah. All right, then. Hi, Uzo. My name is Adeolu. Thank you so much for taking time out to meet with me today.
Nice to meet you.
Yes. Nice to meet you as well. So could you please start by introducing yourself and outlining your role? I know you're the project owner, on this project, and it's quite crucial to make sure we get the right requirements and everything from you from the onset. So can you please give me some context behind a brief background behind the main objectives of this project? I understand it's a data migration project. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. It is one that has been long in the making, but yes, it is. So I'll just give a bit of background. You know, as you know, we're a multinational organization that has been in business for a number of years. You know, so we've always used on-prem servers for all our data. We're regulated by regulated, and we're also regulated by the health ministry as well. So it's very, very crucial that our data is protected and that we treat it properly. But however, because, you know, of the amount of data we've been able to have now, has become very clunky, and our business users, our data analysts, they're all, you know, it's very difficult for them to maneuver. We've actually moved it to Microsoft Azure onto the cloud, but it hasn't really given us basically giving us what we need. So we're looking for another solution that will give us the kind of security we need, that will give us the kind of speed we need in data processing. At the moment, we're going through a number of different vendors, but we haven't really decided on one. So that's where we actually hope that you'd be able to help us.
Oh, I see. Okay, so if I just make sure that I got that right, you're looking to move from your on-premise to a cloud system. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And currently you're using Azure, Microsoft Azure. Are you using that on the cloud, or is that on-premise that you're using?
We actually started moving. We wanted to use that as a solution, but we realized that won't really meet our needs. So at the moment, we're shopping around for another solution. We have different requirements, but Azure doesn't really deliver on it. So at the moment, we don't have any solution at the moment. We have a number of contenders, but we haven't decided yet.
Is that so? Okay, that makes sense. So you're looking for, so Azure is not fully functional now. It still doesn't meet your needs. You need a
No.
product that meets your needs and has
Yes.
the cloud capability as well. So
At
you
the
mentioned
moment, we're still using our servers, yes.
okay. So you mentioned something about compliance. So can you shed a bit more light on the compliance part of it? Because you know what, it's like it's a data, like you said, it's data you need to comply with. Is there complying with GDPR, or what exactly do you have a particular compliance or regulation that you need to follow within the health industry within which you guys play?
Yes, we actually used to we actually used to you we were regulated, or we used to conform to or comply with GDPR requirements, but now with the Brexit split, we're now using data protection, the UK data protection rules, and we have to make sure that we follow them very strictly because, as you know, if we contravene them in any way, we'll be fined very heavily. So we have to follow that regulation. We're also regulated by the financial services regulators, and we're also regulated by the health services. So we have three major regulators. So as you can, it's a bit of a pain, but that's the cost of doing business. So.
Okay, that's fantastic. Thank you so much for that. So can I ask a bit of still a bit of back history? What are the key reasons behind you wanting to undertake this migration now? I'd imagine that, you know, obviously you said you've tried with Azure and some other systems before. So what are the key reasons why you're taking this now? And I mean, why haven't you've tried some things previously? So why now? That's my question. Why now?
Like I said, it's a long time coming. Our current services can no longer handle the volume of data we have. It's no longer fit for purpose. It takes a long time for us to be able to distill the data we want. A lot of times it's not, we don't even get the quality we need. And we know that there are a lot of tools out there that can help us anonymize and simplify data, and we're not using it. So it's costing us a lot as a business, actually. And there's a lot of dissatisfaction with our data analysts and our business users. We want to make sure that we give them the best possible things while complying to all the regulations that we have to. So we're trying to, it's a bit of a balancing act. We just want to make sure that all our stakeholders are satisfied, but at the same time, our business needs are met and our regulators are happy.
And that's fantastic. Thank you so much for that. So, I mean, talking about stakeholders, so who will the primary stakeholders be on this involved in this project? What will be kind of like their main concerns and their expectations, please?
Of course, I will be obviously the liaison with the business, but again, we have the heads of the finance team, the head of the governance team, the head of almost all the heads of the different business units are very invested in this project. They've been asking for it for a while. Our chief data analyst is obviously, this is his pet project. We have many different subject matter experts in the different business units who are also very invested. So you actually have a large pool of stakeholders to talk to, and each one has, a vested interest in making sure that this we're able to deliver on this project. So it's a huge project. I hope you're up to the task.
Oh, yes, definitely. I mean, when it comes to the stakeholders and obviously gathering and validating the requirements, we plan to like schedule probably se several workshops, interviews, surveys to gather detailed requirements and, you know, regular review sessions and feedback on. We'll give you like prototypes, we'll give you visualization. I mean, we obviously this is why I'm having this meeting with you at this point in time, so I can gather detailed requirements from you. And not just you, from all of the other stakeholders as well. Give them a prototype. I'll also come up with the some documentation, which I will be, I mean, after this meeting and after the meeting with other stakeholders as well. Documentations which I will be sharing across all of the stakeholders to get some validation and then hopefully to get a sign off, and we can agree on, you know, we can agree on where we're at right now regarding with the project and the requirements. If
Awesome.
it's
That's very, very good to
So
hear. Thank you so
yes,
much.
that will be good. I mean, so data, I know this is quite it's a crucial project and it's a critical project. And I'm just wondering, I mean, during this process of, migrating, I'm just thinking about the measures that we need, that we might need to take, or we might need to put in place to ensure data integrity and quality during the process. So things like data validation, automated checks, and all of that. Do you have any process that you're using at this moment in time to ensure data integrity and quality, or is this something you're looking to get out of the new system which we're going to implement for you?
Definitely we have that in at the moment. However, remember we're using servers, so it's very
Yes.
protected within our servers. So we're able to, actually put security in place to make sure that, there are no data leaks or hacks. So that's why this project has taken a while, because people are nervous about putting our data on, on the cloud, because a lot of people believe that we're exposing, ourselves, which is why, like I said, it's taken a while to actually get the right solution for this project. And we're still in the process of deliberating and talking to external vendors in order to select the right solution. It's very crucial. It's a crucial part of the project. We want to make sure that our security is still top-notch, our data is protected. We have people's, personal data, financial information, health data, so it's all very sensitive information. So we want to make sure that our customers are, confident in the fact that their information is protected. So yes, it's at the moment, like I said, we have it in place within our servers, but we definitely have to make sure that whatever we're doing, wherever it is we're migrating to, we also have that security, within, the solution as well.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. So I'm going to go back with to the compliance you mentioned about. So you mentioned you have to comply with three different regulators and all of that. I'm just wondering, I'd imagine, or yeah, let me not assume, but I assume that you have like a data governance framework that you currently use within your system that includes like clear policies and processes, procedures for data handling that we can migrate to the cloud project when we finally do that, and compliance and regulation. Do you have that at hand, or is this something that we'll need to come up with, please?
At the moment, we do have some legacy documentation. We have loads of policies, not just governance, but legal, and all the different business units. However, I'm thinking that we're going to have to need to create updated policies, because we're obviously moving data off our premises and onto the cloud. So I, while I'm happy to provide you with the documentation and the policies we have at the moment, I definitely think that we're going to have to create new ones in order to meet the needs of our proposed migration. So yes, I'm happy to give you all the policies we have at the moment from the different business units.
All right, that is fantastic. Thank you. Another key thing is within the current system now, are there other systems that need to integrate with this cloud system? Synchronization of data between different systems. Yeah. So what are the systems that will be migrated onto the cloud, and the systems that will need to interact with the cloud solution when we finally implement it?
It's a very long list. We have
Okay.
loads of different systems for many different things that we do. So I'll be able to send you the documentation with some of those applications and the stakeholders who you need to talk to in order to, get them on board as well and get the requirements you need for the project.
Okay, because one thing we might want to think about is compatibility, between those legacy systems and some systems that you have that you're using and the new cloud system that you've been using, especially in form of legacy data formats and all of that. I mean, I'll put all of that in the documentation. I'll send that through to you just to ensure that
Thank
we have clarity with this. And we also need to ensure that there's seamless integration with all of the systems, and they're being tested to function as expected.
you.
But we
That'll
might,
be
yeah, I mean, but we might, having said all of this, there might be a few challenges that we'll face down the line, and we'll also come up with like a risk map and a mitigation plan, which I will be working with you personally on, how to mitigate some of these risks that come up as we carry on in the project. So I'll do that. So talking of that, we need, I haven't measured risk and talked about risk. How do we then, do you have any KPIs that are critical for this project, or like key success factors that you believe are critical for this project? How will your success will be measured for this migration project, please?
So the business has quite a number of KPIs at the moment. However, because it's a project that has to do with a lot of business units, heads of businesses, I think you might need to reach out to each one to get what their KPIs are, and then we can
Consolidate.
basically,
Okay.
yes, consolidate the information. But I can give you what I have at the moment as a starter, and then we can take it from there.
Okay, that's fantastic. Thank you. I mean, you haven't been in the business, and obviously you're more familiar with the business and what you do. Are there any potential roadblocks that you think or you believe we should be aware of? I mean, anything that you think is crucial, any information that you think is crucial for us to know about, please?
Definitely. I'm pretty sure as the project goes along, we'll encounter a few, but the ones that come to mind, like I talked about, is the hesitancy that comes with moving our data to the cloud. There are a lot of people that are quite uneasy about that. So I think a lot of what we're going to do is make sure we have the right solution to be able to provide the level of comfort and security that is required, and then make sure that we're able to convince and carry our key stakeholders along. To let them know that the solution is just as good, if not better, that having our data just as secure as well, and we're able to meet all our regulatory requirements and still comply, with the different policies of the of our regulators. So yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. Are there any critical timelines that we need to be aware of? Any critical deadlines? Anything that we need to be aware of for this particular project, please?
Yes, at the moment the project is a bit behind. We had a delivery date of early 2025. However, I actually think that with several of the delays that we've gone through, we may have to extend it a bit. But I would definitely say a year and a year and a half. It's a long-term project, so we still
Okay.
have quite a lot of work to do in order to decide what our vendor is, and then the whole migration process will obviously take quite a while. So at the moment, we're working with a long timeline, however, we would like to see regular increments and updates just to make sure that the project is moving as it should.
Okay, so when I'm talking about the timelines, okay, that's, yeah, that's, I mean, that gives us enough room to work with. But like any critical timelines within the business itself, not on this project, but within the business itself that you need to, that this business, this migration, sorry, will impact upon. And we need to be, obviously, we need to be aware of those deadlines so we can actually work towards it. So yeah, we'll take a note of that, but then we'll speak with the SMEs and every and the different business units to know what their specific timelines is and how obviously our projects were impacted and how we can mitigate the risk of any downtime. So yes, we'll definitely put that in the documentation. So going forward, are there any, I mean, going off of the back of that, and are there any business processes that you believe will be impacted by this migration? Would you know, or would this would you know of anyone? We'll still speak to the other SMEs and the other stakeholders, but is there anyone you are aware of that will be impacted by this migration, please?
Be honest, almost all our business processes will be affected. Like I said, it has to do with our customer data, and our customers obviously are crucial to everything it is we do. So we're talking about legal to financial to customer service to, I mean, all our different claims and policies and all of that, everything is sure to be affected. That's why it's a major project. So yes, I actually think most of our processes will be affected by this project.
Okay, we'll make sure all of that is documented and verified.
Thank
So
you.
obviously when it comes to, so now we're going to the external factors. When it comes to external factors regularly, are there any that you believe would have any impact on this project within the next 12 to 18 months?
We believe
Do
that
you
there's some
think
regulatory policy
any
changes.
potential changes that you foresee down the pipeline?
Yes, we have a few that we're monitoring closely that that we'll definitely need to keep an eye on to make sure when it is that it's implemented, we need to make sure that it doesn't disrupt our current business processes, but we're keeping an eye on some of them. I could share some of those with you so you could get sight of them as well.
Okay, that's fantastic. I mean, if at any point those risks that you've seen, if at any point the status changes, obviously I'll be in touch, but if at any point the status changes and you think that that information will be useful to us, you could please let us know. That would be great. So, I mean, I'm just trying to outline the next steps here. What I mean, is there anything else you think will be important for us to know at this stage? Having
So
said
I will
all
go
of this,
ahead.
anything
Yes, I'll go
you
ahead
have?
and set. Yes, so I'll go ahead and set up some of those meetings with the stakeholders, like we discussed, so that you can ask them some of the questions directly. I've had meetings with them as well, and I will be liaising with them. But if they're, I would like to introduce you as well, and just let them know that you're coming on board. And so, if they see correspondence and emails from you, they'll know who you are. So, if at that point you have any questions you want to ask, that would be a nice opportunity to do that. But I will be keeping you, I'll be keeping you informed if and when any information becomes available and I'm able to get any of the questions, or I'm able to get more information, I'm happy to share that with you. So I'll go ahead
Oh,
and set some
fantastic.
of those meetings up. Yeah.
That is very helpful. Thank you so much. I mean, so when it comes to you in particular, now, how often do you are you available for us to check in with you for feedback or update? Would you like us to do you just trying to establish a communication plan here? Would you like us to do you like weekly updates, feedback, or just an email at the end of the day? How often will you or how frequently would you like us to check in with you, please, regarding updates and feedback?
I believe because of the scale and scope of the project, we'll actually be in regular touch. I'm always available via email. I'm also available on Teams. I'm very responsive. So if you have any questions, just let me know. I will definitely be sending you a lot of information. I will send you invites to a lot of the stakeholder meetings that we're having, so you can, we can carry you along that way. So I will definitely be in touch on a regular basis. But if you have any questions at any time, please let me know. I'm available to help in any way I can.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you. Thank you so much for that. And thank you for your time. So, immediate next steps from us will be to give you the prototypes to do you with the documentation for you to validate and hopefully please sign off if you're okay with that.
Sure.
And from your own perspective, it'll be you setting up those meetings as promised, with the other stakeholders just for us to get like a complete understanding of requirements. So yeah, right after this meeting, I'll put all of that into the documentation and I'll send that across to you for you to have a review with, please.
That would be really good. Thank you so much.
You very much for your time, Ozo. And yes, we've been able to gather essential information regarding the project. And yeah,
Look forward to working with you.
fantastic. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes. So that's the end of our show and tell. We're trying to be quite quick here because we know you some people have gone into the DA rooms and some people have broken up. But just to be sure, do we still have everyone? Can somebody just say hi? I hope we still have everyone on the call as well.
Hi.
Hi. We're here.
Oh, hi.
Pause the recording.
We're
Yes.
still
Sorry,
here.
we're here.
Hi.
The DA class is closed.
Hi.
Yeah.
Juliet, please.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. So, Uzo, is that okay? Do you want us to go to Q&A now, or is there
Yes,
anything
of
else you
course.
want to cover?
Of course.
Hello, ladies. Thank you so much. Uzo and Gila. Sorry, hopefully I pronounced the name very well.
Yes, it did.
Yeah. Okay, my question is, what if a requirement is compromised? Will this still be a good requirement or excellent requirement in the sense that we gave example a few minutes ago, like requirement is a specific need. So for instance, I will spoke about somebody wanting a jollof rice as a specific food that they would like to have. For instance, you go to a restaurant and they tell you, oh, the jollof rice is going to take another 1 hour, 30 minutes to be ready. And you're really, really hungry. So obviously, you compromise that jollof rice and you go for something else. Or alternatively, maybe they tell you jollof rice is, you want jollof rice and fish, and they tell you it's £45 and you have just £30. So at that point, you have to compromise that jollof rice and go for something else. So would that still be a good, I don't know if I should use the word a good requirement or excellent requirement. I don't know if you understand my question.
I think so. Adele, do you want to go?
Thank
Or
you.
yeah, I'm happy to go if you want to go. I mean, but you can always chip in also if you feel to. So
Sure.
what if requirements? Requirements, so are you looking from this requirement from this perspective of the business or from your own perspective? From the perspective of the business, they've told you the business need. They've told you what exactly. So as a BA, what you need to do is, for instance, using that jollof rice analogy now, they've told you they want to eat jollof rice. For you as a business analyst, you're a business analyst, you need to analyze what exactly is the root problem. What you need to do something called root, yeah, they will call usually something sometimes called a root cause analysis. What is the problem statement? They want to eat jollof rice. What need are they trying to satisfy by eating jollof rice? Let me give you like another analogy. For instance, now you say a company comes to employ you as a business analyst. Okay, we want to buy a staff bus. And they say, yeah, we want to buy a staff bus. Okay, this is the cost. This is blah, 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 blah. As a business analyst, you need to ask the question, just like Uzzah said, the five whys. Why do you want to buy the staff bus? And they tell you, oh, it's because our staff are coming in late. I want to be able to provide transportation for them, blah, 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 blah. So you delve in and you understand the reasons why the staff are coming in late. Some people might tell you, oh, they're coming in late because they're doing school runs in the morning. Some people are saying they're coming in late because of taxi. Because there's no bus, there's traffic, or the cost of transportation is too expensive. So, are there easier ways to answer that problem, or are there easier, better solutions to that particular problem? So, you need to understand the problem statement, why they're asking, why. You always need to understand the why. Why are they asking for these things? And prefer recommendations. So, you're not shoving it down the throat, you're just providing recommendations. For the reason why I think, okay, this might be a better way. For instance, the staff was that I've just given you as an example now. Oh, you can tell them, oh, what if you think of virtual working? So that way, people are not complaining of traffic, people are not complaining of having to do school runs and all that. What about embracing hybrid working? What about embracing, things like that? You at the BA, you are providing recommendations. Sometimes the business don't even know what they want. They come and tell you they want this thing, but you need to understand the why behind it. Once you understand the why behind it, then you're able to understand the requirement in full detail and you're able to provide recommendation to that. Hope that answers your question. Now, Uzo, please feel free to chip in.
Sure. That was actually quite good. I just want to add as well that in projects, a lot of times things change. So I don't know if that's what you mean by compromise.
Yes, that's what
Yes,
I was
so
thinking
things
about.
change, and projects usually have a change management process. So that's another reason why you always need to verify, validate, get things signed off, do all of that. You need to, because if when things change, someone can, firstly, they can tell you, oh, I didn't tell you that, number one. So you need to get them to sign off on their requirements. Secondly, if things change, they need to come back again and tell you, okay, we need to change a few features, blah, blah, blah. And that's fine. It's normal. So especially in an agile project, you could go for your sprint review and then your PO or your project sponsor tells you, yes, I know I told you I wanted this color before, but I've actually thought about it and we want something different. So that's possible. It's life. Things happen. There could be something that is beyond their control. And because of that, they have to change. They could run out of money. There's so many things that can happen. So most projects have a change management process where even if they've given you a requirement, you've confirmed it, validated it, done all of that, they can still come back and tell you, oh, we need to change this requirement. And then you change it and then you move on. I mean, that's life. So it's not really, I mean, it happens. Let me just put it that way. So I
All
hope
right.
that
Well,
helps.
thank you. Yeah,
You're
thank you
welcome.
so much. Thank you.
Was there anyone else who had their hands up who has a question? You can unmute and ask your question.
Hi, hello. I have a question.
Go ahead.
So she mentioned something about going after stakeholders, and there's been a stakeholder she has been trying to reach, but the person has not been responding. What happens when stakeholders are not cooperative?
So as a BA, you escalated. So usually you're working in a you're working with a project team. So for example, I'm working with a product owner. So I escalated to the product owner. Before I reached out to the stakeholder, I told my project owner that, okay, I need this particular information. In fact, the product owner was the one that gave me the person's name. Like, okay, in order to get this information, this is the, subject matter expert. Go and talk to him. I've reached out to him before. This is the information he gave me. We had like a conflicting, someone else gave a conflicting, information. So I needed to confirm. So the product owner gave me the person's name. I tried on whole of last week, sent emails. He didn't respond. I sent reminders this week. He didn't respond. I went back to the product owner and told him I haven't been able to get a response from him. And they were like, okay, no problem. I'll reach out to him. I have a meeting with him later today. So I'll reach out to him and let him know if I'm not able to get him a few minutes with you, then I'll. I already know what the question is. I can ask him and get the information from you. So there are always ways to get around it. But as a BA, you need to find out how people respond. Some people respond via email like that. Some people respond via Teams. So you understand how people respond. And if you're trying to reach out to someone and the person hasn't reached out to you, you escalate it. So someone else reaches out to them, and usually they respond to the product owners or whoever it is you escalate to. So, yeah, I hope that answers your question.
Yes, indeed. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Unmute and ask.
Hello.
Hi, hello.
Oh, yeah. My name is Robert. Hi. Just following up with what you just said now regarding
Hello, can you hear me?
Hello.
Hi, Chris. Yes, we can hear you. Remy is
Yeah.
asking a question now. You can go once Remy is done.
Okay then. All
Okay.
right, cool.
Can we
Thank
raise
you.
our hands if we have questions so that it's better organized? Thank
Okay.
you.
All right. Thank you. Remy, go ahead. You're muted.
Remy, you're muted. We can't hear you. We still can't hear you. I think I see you talking, but we can't hear you.
Okay.
Okay. We can hear you now, but we can. Okay, Chris, do you want to go? Why Remy is sorting
That's me. All right,
everything?
thank
That's
you.
all right. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll make it quick. I mean, there was a question that just occurred to me during the time you were asking, answering that question, and that is, can you actually bypass a product owner to go straight as a BA? To go straight to the stakeholder, which is the sponsor's project sponsor, to find out any inquiry, that you're looking for. Because I thought, in my own perception, I thought a BA, I mean, the PO should always be around, or should always be involved in such a thing, rather than just going straight down to the stake. I mean, to the sponsor, to the project sponsor. And why you're not getting the response? So I'm just thinking, so what would be the job of a PO in between that time? Of course, the PO is more like a go in between the BA and the stakeholders, I mean, and the project sponsor. So what happened? Does the BA job just stop? I mean, does the PO job just stop at a time when all the information regarding the product, from the project sponsor done? Is that the end of it?
No, okay. Adele, do you want to go or?
Oh, sorry, I'm happy. Also, you can take that if you want to.
All
Sorry,
right,
I'm
cool.
just.
No problem. Yeah, so No, appeal does a lot more than just act as an intermediary, and a lot of times you're in the same meetings. And like I said, the peer was the one who said go and reach out to the person. So it's not like I'm going above the person's head. That some projects are massive. There are loads and loads and loads of things to do. So in order to do my work, I needed to reach out to someone. And he was like, yeah, go ahead, reach out to the person. It's fine. I don't have the info. I asked him. He doesn't have the information I need. So he was the one who literally gave me the person's detail. So it depends on the organization you're working with. A lot of the information we're giving you here is best practice and what should be obtainable. But when you go into different organizations, you see that they operate in different ways. So as a BA, you have to observe what's the hierarchy, what how do things work. That's part of your job as a BA. Remember, we talked about stakeholder matrix and stakeholder management. If you're working with a PO that doesn't want you to be in touch with any of his stakeholders, then you pass all your information to the PO, and your PO, is your link or your bridge. But if sometimes the PO says, yeah, go ahead, ask this person, he has the information you need, you go ahead and you ask the person. So it's not an all or nothing. And again, the PO has loads of things to do. That was literally one little information I wanted that doesn't have anything to do. So it's not even part of his role. If he wants to give you, if he has information, fine. If he doesn't, so it's not all, that's not all he does. Do you understand? That's not all a PO does. A PO does more than that. And again, in some of the meetings, you are with your PO and the stakeholders as well. So if you're in that meeting and you have a question, ask your question. Do you understand? It's not like, oh, everything has to be filtered through the PO. There are certain things that come through, but if you happen to be in a meeting and you have a question, especially if it's the kind of environment where people are allowed to talk, which is the usual work environment, you unmute and, excuse me, I have a question. I need some clarification, so on and so forth. Then you ask a question. So it's not all strict and, this is this person's role, that's that person's role. Different things are obtainable. So I hope that helped.
Yeah, it does. Thank you.
Awesome. No worries. Any other question? Please raise your hand.
Remy, do you still have a question, or are you still having issues with your microphone? Hello, Remy. I think he's dropped off the call. Oh dear. Oh, he's here. Hi, Remy. Does anyone else have any question for Uzo and Ajili, please?
General question, not really, no, not.